The CFRN E-Mini Futures Cast is now on Stitcher. Listen to us on your iPhone, Android phones, BlackBerry, and WebOS phones. Stitcher is smart radio for your phone. Find it in your app store at Stitcher.com. Stitcher Smart Radio, the smarter way to listen to radio.
Are you ready, Steve?
Uh-huh.
Andy?
Yeah!
Bert? Well, all right, fellas. Let's go!
You're listening to CFRN, the Christian Financial Radio Network.
Today's broadcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download at www.audibletrial.com/CFRN. Over 85,000 titles. Choose from mystery, romance, religion, science, technology, business, New York Times bestsellers, even children's books. You name it, Audible has it. With 85,000 titles to choose from, you're sure to find the perfect audiobook for yourself or to give as a gift, and it's absolutely free. Just point your browser to audibletrial.com/CFRN. That's audibletrial.com/CFRN. And become a part of the audiobook revolution by downloading your free audiobook today. audibletrial.com/CFRN.
Hey, trader.
Want to get rich quick?
Well, good luck with that.
If, on the other hand, you actually want to learn how to trade, the place to be is www.cfrn.net. Tune in Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. Eastern, for our daily devotional, and then spend the next 3 hours learning how it's done from professional traders who actually trade for a living. That's www.cfrn.net. Every trading day from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern. CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living.
Good afternoon, traders, and welcome back to the CFRN E-Mini Futures Cast. This is the daily broadcast of indeterminate length, where we discuss all things E-Mini, along with some really big ideas on the finer points of trading gold, bonds, crude, sugar, the euro, and even T-bills. Joining us today from our studios in Boston, Mr. Michael Bork. From our trading desk in Chicago, Mr. Burton Schlichter. Now, to get things started, let's go to our host and founder in Studio A, overlooking South Mountain, America's largest city park. Here's Dwayne.
Hey, good afternoon. Welcome back. Today is Wednesday. Yes, it is. It is the 8th day of June, 2016. Let's take a quick look at the numbers and see what we got. All right, we're going to start here. At home, the Americas. We'll start with the Dow, which is up 62 points. NASDAQ is up 13. S&P 500 is up 6, and the Russell 2000 is up a little over 5. Okay, so that's green, 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 and even a little more green. Okay, let's move on to the rest of the world. Let's stop by our commodity basket first. Crude oil up 79 cents. That's 1.5%. Not bad. And gold, what a nice rebound, $16.60. That's up a little over 1.25%. Turning to the Asian markets, the Nikkei is up 155 points. Shanghai is down 9 points. And the Hang Seng, our $100 billion baby, down 30 points. Last but not least, Europe, the DAX down 70 points, the FTSE up 16, and the CAC down 27. So mixed in Europe, mixed in Asia. But here at home, color of the day, bright green. And that's a good thing. All right, and oil up 79 cents, considering it's trading at 51.15. That puts it up 1.5%. That's not too shabby. So listen, welcome to the show. If you're here for the first time, a very special welcome to you. For those that are returning, welcome back. For those of you that have been coming for years, I don't even need to say anything to you. Just glad to have you with us. If you are new, though, if you have any questions, just type them into the chat box. Now, you should be able to see the chart I have up, which is the S&P 500 E-mini Futures. If you can't see the chart, you may have chosen to simply listen to the audio stream, but we got pictures. Now, if you want to see the pictures, here's what you do. Go to our homepage at cfrn.net. On the right-hand side of the page, click the big microphone, or there's a button below it that says something clever like, click here. Do that, follow the instructions, and within 30 seconds, you'll be registered all the way through the end of the month. Okay. Now, that means you won't have to register again every single day. You'll get an email each morning reminding you about 1 hour before the show starts that says the show starts in an hour. When you're ready to join, click here. And that's all you have to do is just click there and one-click access, and you're in like Flynn. All right? Very good. So, you've heard the numbers. Now, you know what comes next? The Donald. How much damage can one person do to himself if he really wants to be president of the United States of America? He just lost another big supporter. Conservative radio host Hugh Hewitt on Wednesday said the GOP should look to change the rules at this summer's Cleveland convention so it can ditch Donald Trump as its nominee. Who are they going to replace him with? He just beat out the 16 top contenders. The American people, out of a field of, I guess, including him, 17, the American people said, we want him. But now we're going to change the rules so that the party can decide who's going to sit in the Oval Office. The host came to that conclusion after what he called the worst 72 hours for the party in more than 15 years. The worst 72 hours for the Republican Party since 2000 when George W. Bush, when the George W. Bush DUI was dropped, he said on his program, adding, we're going to get killed. We're going to get killed. Hewitt said, with the self-savaging party leaders inflicted on Trump, after he continued to pursue a racial line of attack against a federal judge, was like nothing he had ever seen. I agree. The latest Trump firestone centered around his persistent attacks on U.S. District Judge Gonzalo Curiel over his Mexican heritage. The Manhattan billionaire said Curiel cannot fairly preside over a civil case involving his now-defunct for-profit real estate school, Trump University, because he is of Mexican descent and Trump is building a wall along the U.S.-Mexico border if elected in the fall. So, because of that, he's not fit to sit as judge. Really? By the way, Curiel's from Indiana, not Mexico. Republicans from all sides of the party have publicly condemned the remarks and demanded that Trump change his tone. In a Tuesday late afternoon statement, Trump took a step back from the attacks but did not apologize. He made no mention of his attacks against the judge in his prepared post-primary speech later that night. Paul Ryan had to come out and say those are racist comments, Hewitt said. Senator Mark Kirk unendorsed him. Senator Jeff Flake of Arizona said, well, he might not be our nominee. Mitch McConnell hammered him. It was a day of savaging of the Republican nominee. I've never seen anything like it. And by the end of the day, it was clear. Trump's campaign was in free fall and on fire. He said that Tuesday was the day when it occurred to him that Trump had no chance of winning in November. Acknowledging that Republicans have never defeated Bill and Hillary Clinton, Hewitt said, we're not going to beat her now, not with Donald Trump. Right now, the Republican Party is facing, the plane is headed towards the mountain after the last 72 hours. Hewitt said the Republican Party ought to get together and let the convention decide. He called for a rules change that would inhibit Trump from becoming the party's nominee in Cleveland. And if Donald Trump pulls over a makeover in the next 4 to 5 weeks, great. They can keep him. It would be better if he had done so 5 weeks ago. Hewitt is not the first to suggest Republicans change the convention rules to stop Trump. On Tuesday, the former New Jersey chairman for Ted Cruz's 2016 White House bid said delegates have a moral obligation to launch an insurrection and unbind themselves to halt the billionaires' rise. Moreover, a Wednesday Wall Street Journal editorial suggested that if Trump doesn't start to act like a political leader, he could hear rumblings that delegates are looking for someone else to nominate. So, nobody in the Republican Party is very happy. And, you know, just when everybody was kind of at a point where they thought, you know what, he's doing it. Donald is actually getting ready to begin to act presidential. This whole Trump University thing blows up. And while he could have not swept it under the carpet, but sidestepped it to a degree and said, it's a civil matter, it'll be decided in a civil court, and if I owe a fine, I'll pay the fine. If I'm found innocent, which I believe I will be, you don't attack the judge because he is from Indiana. Yes, his parents may be of Mexican heritage, but the judge is from Indiana. One of the 58 states, as Obama said at one time. Yeah, it's one of the 58. And so here we are, literally on the eve of the election. You know, people keep talking about, well, you know, November's a long time away. I got news for you. November's not that far away. In fact, it's not very far away at all. So, here we go. We'll see what happens next. Michael, if you're ready, sir, if you want to get in here and take care of this recap, you can do it.
Okay, I am ready. Hang on, let me get my recap sheet up. There it is. And let me click that and click no and go over here and change that to me. All right. You should be looking at my spreadsheet.
We got it.
Awesome. Okay. Here we go. All right, good afternoon, everyone. Today is Wednesday, the 8th day of June, 2016. Today, in the live trading room, we made 10 ticks profit on soybeans, 4 ticks profit on the euro, 12 ticks profit on YM. We lost 6 ticks on crude, and we made 10 ticks on gold. Today, it took us one trade and 1 minute to get to our goal for the day, which is $100 a contract, and we took a total of 15 trades. Okay, so now on the month, we are up $917.50. That's over 6 trading days, and we're averaging $152 a day. If you were to apply an $8 commission to every trade we've taken, you'd have a net profit of $277. If you were to apply a $5 commission to every trade we've taken, you'd have a net profit of $517. On the year, we are now up $26,411. That's over 106 trading days, averaging $249 per day. Now, if you were to add one contract per month, this is where you would be. If you got every trade we executed with the exact same fills, this is where you would be, $76,400. Okay, you'd be trading 6 contracts right now. All right. If you have not taken a free trial with us, go here to the homepage at cfrn.net, and in the right-hand side where it says register for a free trial, put in your name, put in your email, click on register for a free trial. When you do that, you'll be sent a confirmation link. You must click the confirmation link, okay? If you don't click the confirmation link, you do not get a free trial. All right? It's as simple as that. Now, let's get into the actual trades. On gold, let's see, we had just a couple of trades on gold. The first one was right here. We got 6 ticks profit on this one, and 4 ticks profit on this one, putting us at plus 10. Then gold did not put in a lower swing until right here, and then went right back up through the BBC. Had a momentum long right there going into dynamic resistance, so we skipped it. Went right back down through the BBC, right back up through the BBC. And then right over here we had a bounce that you could have taken for a break-even trade, and that was it on gold. All right, we had 2 trades on gold, one for 6 ticks, one for 4 ticks. On the YM, we had 4 trades, I think. Okay, our first trade here on the YM, we made 10 ticks profit on that one. Missed that one there and that one there. We stopped out on this one, putting us down to plus 2. Then we made 10 ticks on this one, putting us up to plus 12. And then we had a break even right there. You can see we missed a couple more trades in here. This would have been break even. This would have given some profit, but I missed it. During the break, a long momentum trade right there is about it. Okay. And that was that. Now, the crude oil. Crude. All right. Our first trade on crude was right here. We got a break even on that. This one here we got 1 tick profit on. And we stopped out pretty much to the tick right there. You see, I hate it when that happens. Stopped out pretty much to the tick, and then it went right where we wanted it to go. This was the crude inventory numbers. I said if it gets down here to 50.90, it should get down lower. It didn't work out so well today though. It got down to 50.90, dropped through it a little bit, and then it went right back up here, put in a new high. We stopped out on the next trade, so after being at plus 1, we were down to minus 7, and then right here we're down to minus 15. We got 1 back here, putting us at minus 14, and we got 8 back here, putting us at minus 6. Had a break even there, and it looks like crude really wanted to get up higher today, which didn't make any sense at all to me. Yeah. There was a build yesterday in the API numbers, and it was exactly as expected today in the inventories. And if you were to look at the larger time frame, like look at an hourly chart, you see how much was built into it before we even had our inventory numbers come out. All that was built in from yesterday afternoon. So I was really expecting it to go down, not up. Anyway. That was that. On crude, we ended with minus 6 ticks. soybeans. That's where we got our goal for the day. Our first trade right in here. We got long, took 8 ticks profit, got the goal, and that was it. We missed a trade here. We got 2 more ticks over here, putting us at plus 10. Okay, and then I took this last trade from right up here at the end of the live trading room, but I didn't count it in the live trading room. Okay, I don't remember how much I got on that, 4 or 5 ticks, I think. It gave another opportunity here on the short side, came right back up through the BBC, and that's it. All right, on the euro, I took this one trade right here on the euro, and I got 4 ticks profit. That was it. Anything bid in the crude? Oh, right now, the bid in the ass seem about equal. And soybeans is the only one where it doesn't. Yeah, there were many more longs to be taken in here. Right up in here, John. Could have taken one there, one there, one there, one there. Over here when it was going up, I didn't like it because the cycle was flat near the middle. That's why I wasn't doing anything right in here. Okay. But, yes. Alright, so if you have not taken a free trial with us, go to the homepage at CFRN.net. In the right-hand column, it says register for a free trial. Put in your name, put in your email. Click on register for a free trial. When you do that, you'll be sent a confirmation link. You must click on the confirmation link. Okay. And a recap of what we did. We made 10 ticks profit in soybeans, 4 in the euro, 12 in the YM. We lost 6 in crude, and we made 10 in gold. All right, so we're up 250 on the day. We got our goal for the day in one trade in 1 minute and got $100 a contract. It's the third time this month that we did it in one trade out of 6 days. one of the days we didn't make it at all, and the other day we made it in 2 trades, but we gave it back. And then yesterday we made it in 10 trades. Yesterday was an anomaly. Karen. Reading on. Okay. So anyway, on the month we're up $917.50. So with 6 trading days, we're averaging $152 a day so far. On the year, we're up 26,411. That's over 106 trading days, and we're averaging 249 so far on the year. 15 trades, John. No. Oh, you mean to get the goal for the day? Yeah, just one. Just one. But 15 trades overall today. Okay. All right. And that's all I got, guys. With that, I'm going to hand it back to Dwayne out in fabulous Phoenix, Arizona, if Dwayne is ready. All right, thank you, John. Same to you.
Did you call me?
Yep, we're ready. We're ready.
All righty then. Let's see. All right, there we have it. Go to our good word for the day, and then we'll take a wander through these concierge trade alerts, and of course, along the way, we'll answer your questions. Are there any unanswered questions? Oh, let's see. Karen says, Trump's comments have been cringeworthy this week. Absolutely. But when the smoke clears, can we consider what happens in a court with jury selection? Days and weeks are spent interviewing candidates to secure jurors with the bias that helps the client. If you think judges aren't known for their bias and favoritism, you haven't been watching The Good Wife. Actually, I do. I watched it. It's over. It's the end of the series. It's gone. It's done. Not end of season, end of series. Heartbreaker. Sadly, though, now, her new boyfriend, the private investigator, in case you don't know, he has the new starring role on Walking Dead when it starts up in the fall. He was on the final episode of last season. That's when he made his appearance. And I don't think they shut down The Good Wife due to The Walking Dead, but just so you know, you haven't seen the last of that private investigator from The Good Wife. Sadly, though, Trump said it poorly. He has a habit of doing that, doesn't he, Karen? His point is that he has put himself out there as a controversial figure in the Mexican-American struggle, and any lawyer worth his salt would avoid that judge. Trump has gone out of his way to not be politically correct. Isn't that what drew people to him? Yeah, you're absolutely right, it is. It's a shame. I suspect that people want to get away from posturing and lip service and politically correctness, a cultural trend I fear may one day suffocate us in stupidity. That is well said. That bell's for you. Well said. And to you too, John. You too as well. Okay. All right. Now, we talked about trading strategy today. We talked about political strategy. Let's talk about love, which, according to the Bible, is the winning strategy. 1 Corinthians 13:8, love never fails. The Bible says love never fails. Think about it. Money doesn't bring happiness. Fame doesn't bring self-worth. And revenge doesn't bring satisfaction. The only thing that never fails is love. When Mother Teresa addressed world leaders at the United Nations, she was asked, "How can we have world peace?" She replied, "Go home and love your family." If we all did that, paradise lost would become paradise found. Napoleon Bonaparte's intellectual greatness and intense egotism make his alleged tribute to the supremacy of leadership by love all the more striking. He said, "Alexander, Caesar, Charlemagne, and I myself founded great empires, but upon what did the creations of our genius depend? Upon force. Jesus alone founded his empire upon love. And to do this, you can't love others without making..." I should have thought about that when I put that phone number out there. Jesus alone founded his empire upon love, and to this day, millions would die for him. Would you die for Alexander or Caesar or Charlemagne? I don't think so. Sometimes leaders are just power holders, because you can't love others without making yourself vulnerable. They see expressing love as a weakness. Yeah, see, in life, in politics, in business, people all too often see kindness as weakness. But the fact is, you can't love and keep all your options open. To truly love, whether it's your spouse, your children, or the people you lead, you must give yourself unreservedly in such a way that you can be hurt and even rejected. The fundamental principle on which power holders operate is to protect themselves and everything they have. Whereas the fundamental principle of true leadership is to give of yourself with no holds barred. Love as an intrinsic characteristic of leadership seems outmoded, yet according to Scripture, it's still the winning strategy. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's why love is the winning strategy. That is why love never fails. That's why love beats out money and everything else. And that's part one of this week's series, Love, the Winning Strategy. We all need more of it, and we all know where to get it. And we'll dive a little deeper into it as the week moves on. So let's go to the alerts. Straight away, right away. Because I got appointments, and I got a webinar tonight, and I got, mentoring this afternoon, and it's a busy, busy day here at the CFRN studios. Okay, last night we got the alerts out fairly early for a change. Got them out at 7:55 p.m. Eastern. So we'll call that 8 o'clock, which is 2,000 hours for you non-military folk. 2,000. Almost. There we go. Okay. Here's what we were looking to do. We were looking to buy 2113. Important prices, important areas, almost always tested. All right, buy 2113. And we did actually put in a higher high as we continue our climb up to our number of the week, 2526. Leg, retrace, leg. Now, this first move up took us to a swing high of just 1475. But the whole move, the entire move, leg, retrace, leg. Here's the big leg. The big leg took us all the way to 21.1875. So that's 5 3/4 points. 5.75. All right. And then we get back below the trigger. Up we go again. Here's a swing high at 17.75. So that's 4.75. Now, the S&P 500 pays $50 per point. And so you do, in fact, need 2 points a day in order to make your daily goal. $50 a point times 2 points, $100, $100 per contract. Day after day after day allows you to slowly build your account. You never have to make more than 2 points a day. And at the end of 24 months, you can graduate as a 20-contract trader. And at that point, you don't ever have to concern yourself. Most people, the common man, doesn't have to concern himself with income beyond that. Okay? Do the math. That's a pretty good payday. Okay? Now, 21.13 up to the swing high. See, leg, retrace, leg. Now we're getting a retracement. This was a lower high, but that's okay. We're not done with this week yet. Today's only Wednesday. Okay? All right. Let's move to the Dow. It's next on the agenda. We'll find it. And there it is. Okay. And we'll drop our marker at 2000. You know, my old buddy Mark Faulk was supposed to show up today. He gets confused. I hope you're listening, Mark, so you can hear me say that. He gets easily confused. Let me see if he's over here. No, not yet. Oh, it's okay. He may still show up. He hasn't answered my email yet. Or my text. His email yesterday goes, "Now, you mean like Wednesday, tomorrow, right?" And so I said, "Yeah, like tomorrow." He goes, "Okay." For those of you who don't remember, Mark and I, Mark was my first co-host on CFRN way back in 2005 when we birthed CFRN for the purpose of fighting naked short selling. Now, there's this text right there. Sorry I got sidetracked with film stuff. Still have time to have me on. This is Mark, by the way. Yes, Mark, come on. The world awaits, my friend. Yeah. He started out in radio with me, and now he's a big shot film guy. You'll get to hear all about it. Trust me. He's going to be an interesting new addition to the show. Larry got a question. I'm a new partner and I have some questions. Is there a fixed link for the morning trading sessions rather than watching my email for the link? Well, it's the same link every day, each week. It changes every week. So once you have the link Monday morning, once you register Monday, then you can save that link and not wait for the email or however you want to do it. The email gets sent out an hour before the room opens, so it's not like you have to actually wait for it. Is there a list of regularly scheduled webinars or times and links? Yeah, we do the live trading room every day at 9:30. We do the radio show every day at noon. We do the partners meeting every Thursday night at 9 o'clock. Should I still be getting all the promotional CFRN emails? No, not really. I'll take your name off the promotional list. Hang in there, buddy. I'm glad to hear you're doing well. Anytime you have a question, shoot me an email. I won't always answer your questions on live radio, but I'll make sure they get answered. Okay. All right. I'm sure Michael will answer that ticket in the live chat since I'm on live radio, so I won't bother with that. Okay, Linus wants to attend the session tonight. I will give you a call back, Linus, if you're tuned in. Okay, I certainly will. All right, so Mark's going to be here in 5 minutes. For those of you that don't know Mark Faulk, how do I introduce you to him? Well, let me do the Dow real quick while I got it up here. By 17,950. Okay. That's what the email said that it sent out last night by 17,950. Okay. Now, depending upon your stop placement, okay, if you triggered here and you had your stop properly placed, you didn't get stopped out, and it ran right up and gave you from 17,950, it took you to... How about that, 62 ticks. Also, I don't have as much time as I once had, but you can always go to, let me pull up a fresh window. How about that? Show you a couple things. Show you a thing or two about a thing or two. Okay. emini.cfrn.net. All right. They're getting that sorted out. Their logo is showing up now instead of our logo, but when you click that, it takes you to our daily paper. Okay? And it's actually supposed to show this and not that. But that's not what I wanted to show you. What I wanted to show you was there are a lot of charts from yesterday. The bond alert. You just click it and blow it up. Okay. Shows you exactly where the trigger was, exactly how far we ran. There's bonds, crude oil. Okay. We had a nice leg here, good for $320. Then we had a nice leg here, good for $480. And the list goes on. So there's crude, and what else did I do last night? I did gold. Gold was a good day. So I had a chance to get at least three of them out there. But now let me show you. Let me show you who we're going to talk to here in a minute. He's not your typical CFRN guest, but a reminder is he was one of the first CFRN guest, co-host. Mark Faulk for House District 88, Oklahoma City activist and filmmaker. Mark Faulk, Truth Out. He wrote the book, The Naked Truth, Investing in the Stock play of a lifetime. He and I spent a couple of years chasing that. Now, we've always said that we would welcome someone who wanted to conversate from the other side of the aisle. Well, guess what? No one walks the other side of the aisle, but yet maintains a conservative heart better than this guy. It's a real balancing act, but he manages to pull it off. Okay, so I got to keep an eye on my list over here to see when he pops up. Say he'll be here in 5 for him. That could be... well, I don't want to go all Donald Trump and say that could be a Mexico 5. If you've ever vacationed in Mexico, though, you understand that five minutes just means a while. Okay? It's not a derogatory remark. So, anyway, we're going to talk to Mark here in a few minutes when he meanders in, and then I'm going to trick him into coming back on a weekly basis. Important prices, important areas are almost always tested, so it's no surprise that price gets down below the trigger, pops up again, gives you enough for your daily goal, gets below the trigger, pops up again, gives you enough for your daily goal. Okay? I mean, that move there is from 50 to it's 45 points. 45 points in an hour and a half. Okay? That's if you started trading at 11 o'clock. So, let's go look at the Russell. Okay. Here's the Russell. Now, what were we looking for on the Russell? Russell by 1182. Okay, clear as day. That's what it said, by 1182. So let's drop a line at 1182. Okay, so now the Russell, a little different than the S&P because it pays twice as much. The S&P is $50 a point, the Dow's $5 a point, the Russell's $100 a point. So if you got long here, per the message, per the email, at 1182, right there, this first move up took you to, get this out of the way. You can't see it, but I can. 1182. $1,183.60. So that's $160 per contract. When we get back below the trigger, off we go again. And this time, we go all the way to 85. So from 82 to 85, that's $300 per contract right there. And then we get back below the trigger. Off we go again. This time we make it all the way up to 88.60. So from 82... to 88 is 6. So that's a $660 per contract move. I can read that right. No, that's not right. Yeah. We'll call it 600 plus. Just this move. Don't forget you had this move which gave you your points for the day. and this move, which gave you your points for the day, and this move, which gave you well beyond your points for the day. So, all right, so we'll just call it $600 plus per contract available. Apply and an OK, and there you have it. So for all you Russell traders, ring a ding. He didn't get the link. Send again. Okay, Mark. For you, I'll send the link again. I have a new computer here, the one I'm using now to do this with. It is, beyond a shadow of a doubt, one of the slowest computers that man ever built. And it's actually a new computer. It's running Windows 8 point something. That's insane. See, it's taken this long just to send an email. Can you believe that? I haven't even read the email yet. Something's seriously wrong with it. I think it needs to go back to the factory. But it's been so long. I wouldn't know which factory to send it to. And no, this wasn't one of those that fell off the back of a truck. I actually paid good money for this. Come on, come on, come on. Okay. Wow. What an endeavor. I'm going to be left with no choice but to replace this computer with yet another computer, because it doesn't seem to be anything you can do to make this thing behave. Oh my. All right, this guy better have some good stuff to talk about after all this aggravation getting him on his show. Man, it's been weeks. All right, Mark, I sent it. Okay. All right, so we knew we did good on the S&P. We did good on the Dow, we did good on the Russell. I know it's going to take him a minute once he gets the email to get logged in. So let's go take a look at another market. We normally go to crude, I believe. So why not today? Okay. All right. So here we go. 100. All right. What was the alert? The alert on crude oil was to buy 50.55. And that was right there. Just enough to test your stop and possibly stop you out at 50.55. But then, looky here, 51.12. And we put in a high all the way up at 51.34. Now, if we'd have gone to 55, that would have been $1,000 per contract. We didn't go quite that far. So let's just calculate it to this little swing high here. We'll go 50, 62, 57. I probably got that wrong. But that's $570. Per contract available. Okay, we never get out at the exact swing high or the exact swing low. Why? Well, because we trail our stop or we trade to a hard target just enough to get our points for the day. So whichever way you traded it, that's what happened in crude oil. Okay? $600 per contract on the table. If you've worked your way up to a 10-contract trader, well, you can do the math. All right. Hey, there's Mark. Mark Faulk, welcome to the show.
How are you? I wasn't sure if I was on or not. It said I was listen only.
Yeah, well, I have to open up your mic when you come on.
Just in case I'm one of the crazies. Do the crazies still exist, or are they all gone now?
You know, I was going to ask you that question. I mean, the old, what was that place called? Pal Talk? Is that what that was called?
Yes, yes.
Do those people still gather there?
They probably do. There are a handful of them, and not, I wouldn't say that specific group, but the old CMKX shareholders who are on my Facebook and still comment sometimes.
Yeah.
But
are they still waiting for a check? Are they?
I think there are a handful who are. That's a little sad, you know. And as always, I don't like to minimize the plight or mock what anybody went through, because it was hell for a lot of people.
Lives were lost over that.
Yeah, exactly.
And I take it Urban Cassavant is still romping free in the wilds of Canada. I mean, he was never indicted or anything, right?
No, actually, Urban Cassavant supposedly died.
And I
only say supposedly because I don't know that I believe anything I hear to this day about that. But he was never arrested, but he, according to news reports, passed away in Canada at some point. And, you know. There we go. I see you Googling it there.
Man in Diamond. This goes back to 14. Urban Cassavant is dead, but don't expect all the suckers who dumped millions into his diamond mine stock scam to believe it. In fact, the cult of Cassavant and the CMKM diamond swindle continue apace despite the officially confirmed end of the line for the penny stock mastermind. Well, you know, if you are being chased by practically everybody on planet Earth, you know, there was a point in time For those of you that don't know, once upon a time there was a company. It wasn't really a company, but it was made to look like a company. And it was called CMKM Diamonds. And it was a cult sort of a thing. And it was almost hard to meet someone who did not own shares. Right, Mark?
That's actually true, and that's especially true as you got around the Las Vegas area where a lot of this scam emanated from, up in Canada. It kind of spread out from there. You know, you could, I wouldn't be surprised if there were people right here in Oklahoma who were shareholders. And yeah, you're right. There were over 50,000 shareholders at some point. And the cult quality of it, it's interesting because people invest in these little penny stocks all the time, and they come and go every day, and they, you know, and every, I haven't really followed the market scams like I did during that era, but you see the collapse of a penny stock company probably once a week or something, I'm sure, very day.
Daily.
But most people just kind of go, damn, I made a bad investment, and I'm going to move on, and you try to follow that advice that I'm sure you still give to your investors. Don't invest anything you can't lose. Do your due diligence first. You learn all these lessons.
Mark, we don't even do equities on the show anymore. I mean, I have thought of going back to equities to some degree in some way on the show, but we have been completely futures, purely electronic. There's no middleman, there's no market maker, there's no pump and dump. It's a purely electronic market, FIFO, first in, first out. My order, you know, for one contract gets the same respect as Goldman Sachs' order for 100 contracts. I mean, it really is a level playing field, all things considered. I mean, it really is.
Well, and we're in a volatile market, and I don't know what your opinion of the market is right now, but I'm starting to feel the sensation of that same bubble that happened in 2008 and in 2000, and you know the various times that it happens. We're almost defying gravity again in the stock market, so especially on individual stocks, you have to be very beware of that. So I think you're doing a very intelligent thing by not jumping into what can be volatile and chaotic and frankly cost you a lot of money in a short amount of time. You know, the CMKM thing though was I think different, and you kind of ended up in the middle of this as well because your show and then what I was involved with it as well, and we were doing a show together, your show became kind of a verbal meeting place for a lot of the shareholders.
An epicenter.
Yes, exactly. And I think they broke the actual golden rule, which is to never get emotionally married to your investment.
Oh, gosh. And we used to warn them. I mean, there's copies of press releases that I did warning people. Press releases I paid for out of my own pocket, warning people to be wary, to be careful, to be cautious, and yet, now, here's the question, and I think this is the direction you started in a moment ago. Penny stocks come and go every day, you know, they blow up, they fall down, they blow up, they fall down. What was it about this one in particular that people not only got married to, but it was, I mean, guys, we don't take this lightly. People lost their lives over this. People took their own lives over this. Businesses were lost. Homes were lost because people believed. They just believed. This is a daily chart of the S&P. I don't know. Can you see my chart, Mark? Are you in a?
Yes, I can.
Yeah. So this is a daily chart of the S&P 500. And one of my guests, who's a technical analyst, long-term kind of a guy, he looks at things like 40-year cycles. he and many others really think this thing is, you know, overcooked, overbaked, overdone, and due for, you know, quite a serious tumble. But back to CMKM for a minute. Why did this, what was the secret sauce in this one that made so many people such devout believers?
You know, that's a good question. I think there are probably a number of reasons behind that. One is that a lot of these people were people who didn't necessarily invest in stocks before. There were some of them that came over from some other companies, PCBM and some Asia. I can still remember all these and reel them off, you know, off the top of my head. But
dude,
one
you're
scam.
The, you're the guy who wrote a book about this. You made a movie about this. I mean, if anybody could remember, you should. Gosh.
Yeah. As much as I have tried to forget some of it, it's still there. You know, and I've moved over on to other social political battles.
I see
continue
you ran for
that.
Office. You didn't even tell me. But let's stay on the CMKM for a minute, and then we'll talk about your running for office. But so,
all right.
What do you think? What was it about this little diamond mine that wasn't?
Well, I think there's a number of things that happened here. I think one is that we pulled in people, and I say we, Urban Cassavant, a guy named John Edwards, not the political John Edwards, but...
No, I had up on the screen here just a second ago, U.S. versus John Edwards. Is he in jail?
Yeah, I'm looking at that, actually. And this is an update very recently. It says
March
trial...
2016.
Yes, trial date August 9th, 2016. I didn't know that, so this is coming up. It's interesting that we are sitting here talking about this after years, and all of a sudden we're, it looks like, a month and a half away from the trial date. So that's, or 2 months away from the trial date. That's pretty interesting. He was in, he escaped to the Virgin Islands.
He escaped to the Virgin Islands?
And yes, and the thing that happened with that was that there was this was after the book happened. At the time that the book I wrote, which was The Naked Truth, Investing in the Stock Play of a Lifetime, the time that book was written, no charges had been filed whatsoever against any of the fraudsters. There had been a handful of civil charges filed by the SEC, but that's clearly not the same as a criminal indictment. When Obama became president, I was working at the time with Kevin West and Bill Frisell, who were trying their best. I will say this. They were trying their best.
Are they still around?
Kevin worked with TogiNet for a while, which was a radio station that kind of grew sort of out of this. He is now, I think, back at his hometown in Texas, which I probably won't throw out even the name of the town because Lord knows, you know, what will happen. Kevin
is a great guy. Is TogiNet still alive?
It is still alive. It is only the radio station. I think they're at about a break-even point. I do a Thursday radio show for them. Kevin asked me to come in and kind of just do a, you know, once a week.
Are my kajillion shares worth anything?
They're at least worth the paper that they're written on. Okay. Beyond that, I couldn't tell you. So right. As the price of paper goes up, hang on to those. You never know. But right. But I do know that there are still, I think, a handful of lawsuits out there. And there's still Bill Frisell and some other people are still...
I mean,
sort of wading through the muck and mire, but it's incredible that this won't die. That's amazing to me. That's just amazing to me. There's very little action on it. They have they've won several judgments against a lot of these people, but collecting on them is another story altogether. So I can't really tell you the current status, but I do know it hasn't really died. This is the most slow. Either it will be a phoenix rising from the ashes, or it's the most slow, painful death in the history of companies. I don't know which one, you know, and I don't even want to venture a guess. But, you know, here we are. So Urban Cassavant flees to Canada, never to return. John Edwards flees to the Virgin Islands, and about, I think it was 2008, around the time that Obama became president, they asked me to kind of get involved with CMKM a little bit, and I did for a short period of time, and I wrote a letter through Robert Shapiro, and again, there's two Robert Shapiros. This guy is the economist who spoke out against naked short selling and stock market fraud. He was one of the early people like you and I and other people that no one believed that there was a problem with the market, and then everything collapsed in 2008, and everybody went, oh, crap, you know, yes, apparently there is a problem here, you know. And we were vindicated in a way that I would have rather not been vindicated.
Yeah, I would have rather been wrong, right.
Exactly. And Shapiro was on Obama's transition team as an economist. So I wrote a letter to, and I sent it to Shapiro, but I also sent it to Obama, and I sent it to the DOJ and the FBI and the SEC, all these names of people who supposedly were working on indicting the criminals, but they never got indicted. I really think it got shelved, stuck in a file drawer, and was gathering dust. And I sent off this letter and this email to about 15 people, including senators on the, you know, budget committee, you know, and all the people that I thought might have some or Senate banking, have some say in this. I didn't expect to get a reaction. Within an hour, I got a phone call from the FBI.
Did you really?
Yes, and they said, the guy first said, so we drew straws and I got the short straw. I was elected to call you. And I said, okay, well, good. What are you going to do about this? And we began to talk. And eventually myself and Kevin and Bill Frizzell flew out to Las Vegas and sat in a room with two DOJ officers, officials, or attorneys, I guess, two SEC officials, two FBI agents, and two IRS agents, all sitting in a big room around a big table. And I laid out all of my research for the book, and Bill laid out all of this evidence that him and Kevin and other people had gathered. And a lot of the, frankly, a lot of the shareholders turned out to be very, very kind of instrumental in putting together the factual information that eventually brought down this scam. So that's the interesting thing about it, is that usually these scams come and go, people get away with it, they move on to another one. Well, eventually John Edwards was traced to over 100 penny scams, 100 of them. So likely he ripped off, along with the other people involved, Ed Donow and Cassavant and whoever all was involved in these, Jeff Torino, all these people, likely they ripped off over $1 billion altogether if you put all the scams together. So they were huge fraudsters. And literally the DOJ, the guy who was running it, what was his name? I lost one of them. But anyway, the guy who was in charge of that, he actually said, you know, goes, how do we try a case like this? It's so complex and it's so ugly and it's so convoluted by design that it's hard to put this case together and put it in front of a jury, you know. And I basically said, if it was me, I would say, here's $1 million check that Urban Cassavant wrote to his wife Carolyn 2 days before Christmas, out of corporate accounts. Here's another $1 million check he wrote to his son, you know, on the same day. Mm-hmm. And then here's a stack with 100 more checks that he wrote to relatives and to himself, mm-hmm. out of court, you know, and just throw that stack on there. And then I would say, here's a forged stock certificate forged by John Edwards, you know, for 1 billion shares.
Yeah,
and here's another one.
This guy used to walk around with a stock certificate book in his back pocket. I mean, just
literally. Yeah.
Writing stock shares left and right.
Yeah. And then I would throw up a stack and say, here's 100 more just like. In other words, show us the ugliest, but don't bury them in minutiae of detail. So John Edwards flees to the Virgin Islands while CMKM, now under Bill Frisell and Kevin West, are suing the crooks. They have to get a signed that had to do with legal documents, and they had it notarized, and it was notarized from the Virgin Islands. And we get that. I call up the guy from the DOJ and say, we think we know where John Edwards is. They go and arrest John Edwards, and that's when they issue all the indictments, because they held off until they could track him down. They didn't want him to know that they were getting ready to do criminal indictments. So they arrest him and issue the indictments on the same day. I get a phone call again from the DOJ, and they say, we're indicting them tomorrow. Don't tell anybody. So I go, okay. And so it's a very odd thing, because we end up getting pulled into the middle of this. I assume that Kevin West may have to testify, and possibly Bill Frisell as well, in this hearing, because they were involved and they know people, you know. So right. Here we are years later. We're talking 6 years after the scam ended and everybody fled, and they're now getting ready to go to trial finally. So that's, to me, that's really fascinating. I'm curious. Sometimes I think there's a sequel in here, but I'm not sure I want to be in the middle of it. But I think what happened was, you involved people who didn't really ever get involved in stocks, a lot of them. Not all of them, but a lot of them. And you tell them that they're going to get rich. And apparently, Urban Cassavant was a very charismatic person. He had that cult leader persona. And he would go...
He had the race car. He would go to the children's hospital.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. He sold stock to soldiers in Afghanistan, which was horrible, a horrible, horrible thing. But how can this guy be a crook? He's hanging out with the soldiers, and he's going to visit people in the hospital, as you said, and he's throwing money around, and he's walking around with raw-cut diamonds in his pocket, you know? And how can this be a scam? And, oh, this fell through, but that's okay. It was all part of the plan, because now we brought in Bob Mayhew, who...
Gosh, I forgot that name for a minute.
Yes, who was on the board of directors and famous because he was Howard Hughes' right-hand man in Las Vegas.
Yep.
I later had conversations with Bob Mayhew, and they all said, well, Bob Mayhew was brought in because of his CIA connections, which all that's true, except for the fact that he was, at this point, honestly just an old guy who they were paying money to put his name on their board of directors list and then use his credibility to give false credibility to CMKM. But they kept coming up with these things. How could it be a scam? This guy's... It's a big sting operation, and they would float rumors, and each rumor would explain the last lie and the last unresolved or unsubstantiated rumor. And it's kind of like that deal where you lie, and then you lie to cover the lie, and then you lie to cover the lie, and then you lie to cover the lie. And as long as the person you're lying to wants to believe it, because the end game is I'm going to be a millionaire, then you can keep lying and get away with it. And that's I think, what happened. It was a very interesting phenomenon, truthfully. I mean, I hope we learned lessons. I will say this. All those people that were involved and everybody they've talked to since, I hope they all said, never do what I did. I hope some greater lesson came out of this that helped to tamp down a little bit this horrible world of penny stock companies, you know, of which some are legitimate and lots of them aren't. And it's gambling. It's just casino gambling, you know. So.
Yeah. Unbelievable. I mean, this goes back to, gosh, I mean, you and I started in 2006.
Yeah. I started covering stock market fraud in 2004 at a time period when we were crazy. And then CMKX came on my radar about 2006. That sounds about right.
Yeah. So you wrote the book. You made the movie with our buddy Darren, who I still have a page up to this day in memory of Darren. I'm sure many of you have seen it. Let's see, archive.cfrn.net. And then you go, this is the old site, so it's not fully functional, but, oh, I don't know why the picture's not loading. And these are all, right here, these are all podcasts that I did with Darren, who was, what a, I can't understand why the picture's not loading, but what a great guy he was.
He was one of those people that when you talk to him, here's the fascinating thing. Later it came out, he told me that he started out, he first got involved in the market itself because he had a brother, I think it was, who worked for this little trading firm. And he said to Darren, and this is very true, said, you know, you can sell ice cubes to Eskimos, as they say. You know, you'd be great in this. You should get involved in trading. You could make some good money. So he does. He gets involved in it. That company turns out to be the company that eventually the Wolf of Wall Street is made about.
Oh, Stratton. Okay, I know who you're talking about.
Yeah. The one Oakmont Stratton. Exactly. Yeah. That Leonardo DiCaprio plays the main guy. Well, Darren would have been one of those traders sitting in there, of course, fictitiously played in the movie,
Sure.
But he had a moment there. But the difference was Darren was, how do I put this, honest and naive enough that he wasn't aware it was a scam. And he would begin to sell shares of this company that they were touting, Virgin, which turned out actually did have a good treatment for cancer, but was manipulated and went under. And eventually Virgin's treatment was produced and used in Europe, I think Switzerland, if I remember right. So it was a real thing. But Darren came to the realization that he was part of a scam. Mm-hmm. So instead of... staying with that and just making the easy money, he's out in 1998 or something like that, 95 maybe even, in front of the SEC, and at the time World Trade Center 7, protesting with signs. He's the crazy lone guy that everybody looks at. Get out of my way. He got arrested several times. You're a total nut. What are you doing here? Go away. The stock market's perfect. There's nothing wrong with it. You know, and he was kind of Mel Gibson in Conspiracy Theory. You know, don't believe this guy. He's crazy. And then all of a sudden, years later, oh crap! The guy we thought was crazy was absolutely right. He knew it before any of us. And I think Darren's story is a movie. I mean, he was a phenomenal, kind-hearted human being, and fought as hard as anyone to correct the market, you know, before the collapse, years before the collapse, and everybody laughed at him and made fun of him for the longest time, you know. But I admire him as someone who just said, no, I believe this, and I'm standing up for it, and it's the right thing to do.
And he did. So. And he lived a meager existence as he fought this fight. He lived in, I forget, somebody's basement, and... they would help him with food and whatnot as he went, because he became very sick towards the end. And
in a horrible twist of irony, while he was fighting for a company who had a viable treatment for cancer, Darren got cancer and died from cancer. And we tried to get the Virgin treatment for him, and they couldn't get it shipped from Switzerland to the U.S.,
And would it have saved him? I really don't know. But that's you couldn't make up a story like that in Hollywood, you know. But yeah, he was a good soul, and I wish that there were more people who would stand up in that way against all odds, just because they think something is right.
So after the book, after the movie, what have you done with your life?
How much time do we have? Because
we got some time.
We got a minute. All right. I'll try to give you the short version. I did the book. I did a film called The Wall Street Conspiracy, which wasn't really about CMKM. It was about the overall stock market fraud. Mm-hmm. We were finishing editing on the film in New York at the time of the collapse. So what we were supposed, I was supposed to be helping to write what was supposed to be a cautionary tale, you know, a warning, this is going to happen if we're not careful, mm-hmm. and we don't do something about it. Well, everything collapses, so then we have to go back and re-edit. It becomes post-mortem.
Right.
You know, it becomes this is how it happened, and we've been telling you for years. So I did that. I came back to Oklahoma, and I promoted the film some, went out to some screenings nationally. But the first screening I went to, when I was here, Occupy started. And I got involved in Occupy in Oklahoma City, and kind of because they were talking about Wall Street fraud at first. And I thought, great, you know, this is the next level. There are people speaking out about this. And at some point, they did the premiere of the film in New York, and as I went to board the plane to go see the premiere of The Wall Street Conspiracy and to speak at it and all that, I was stopped at the front counter at the airport.
No.
and it turns out I am on the terrorist watch list. So I haven't flown in a couple of years, but to this day, to my knowledge, I'm still on that list. I went to Europe one time. It took 7 hours of searching, and I missed a flight and had to spend the night in Minneapolis coming back from Europe. And I get searched for hours every single time I fly. And I can only, of course, surmise that my background questioning, because the thing that they cite, and they won't tell you, they won't say you're on the list, except that the guy at the airport yelled to the TSA people he's on the terrorist watch list. So I got tipped off early, and eventually I would talk to them each time I went in, and they get on the phone for 2 hours, and it's horrible, you know. But they told me, they finally said, yeah, you're on this list, and here's how we. And I'd turn my camera on and I'd film it. So I have all this footage of them explaining how I'm on this list that they're not supposed to confirm that I'm on. So I can only surmise that it had to do with my anti-Wall Street corruption stance, and then also the fact that I got involved in Occupy. It's the only thing I can really come up with based on that happening. So that I eventually did run for office. I've been doing a lot of state politics in Oklahoma, a lot of justice reform, and there's a couple of companies that I've dealt with a lot on film. I'm doing a documentary right now called Voices in a Jailhouse, so you can actually look that up on YouTube and see a couple of kind of early trailers on that film. And we're wrapping it up right now. We're in the end of editing on it. And one of our stories is a guy who was arrested and charged with possession of cocaine. He was a black businessman in Kingfisher, Oklahoma, which is a highly racist small community, and he got life without parole back in the 90s. So he's one of the focuses of the story.
The Larry Yarbrough story?
Yes, okay. Yes. And okay. He's a great guy, and his crime was that he was a successful black business owner in Kingfisher, Oklahoma. And that's actually true. But he got swept up in that three strikes and you're out and minimum mandatory sentencing and all those things. And as I dug into that, of course, I find out that then CCA and Geo Group, both of which are traded on the stock exchange, the largest for-profit prison companies in the world and in America, you know, they make massive amounts of money. And so I'm working on a film that has to only do with justice reform, and of course it goes back to Wall Street, and it goes back to money on Wall Street and greed on Wall Street. And one of the guys we interviewed says, you know, you can invest in bodies on Wall Street, bodies behind bars on Wall Street. And so I've done that. I did run for office. I was outspent 10 to 1. I raised $12,000 to $13,000. My opponent raised 130, and I lost by 80 votes. And I may run again in 2018.
You only lost by 80 votes. Huh.
Yes. Yeah. Might have been 84.
How many
like
votes
that,
were cast altogether?
It was state legislature, so I would say about 4,000 to 5,000, something
wow.
like that. They're
Man,
usually
you only
they're
missed
pretty
by 80. Huh.
Yeah, they're pretty low numbers usually, and it's a doable thing. I may run again in 2018. A lot of people want me to. I didn't run this year, even though Oklahoma, if you look up Oklahoma and budget crisis, you'll find an ugly, ugly story. You know, we've sold our soul in Oklahoma to again, the same thing. Major corporate interests got massive tax breaks, Chesapeake and Devon. Here it's mostly oil companies, but oil companies are Wall Street in Oklahoma. So, and now we have a $1.3 billion budget shortfall, and schools are closing one day a week, and some of them are just shutting down, and buses aren't running. It's a horrible situation. Mental health budgets are cut to the bone, and it's just, you know, our roads and bridges are coming apart.
What's happening to these kids? They're doing a 4-day work week?
Basically, and at the same time, of course, we're cutting out all other social services, so they don't have anywhere to go on that fifth day. A lot of them are not getting. We've passed this on to the backs of the poor citizens of Oklahoma, and I guess in a way this really is the same kind of scam, but I became attached to it because once you go visit an actual person in prison, it becomes, I guess, maybe even more real to you than watching people's fortunes be made and lost on the stock market. You watch this guy and you see his family who love him very dearly and who are still fighting for his release 22 years later. Even jurors in the case are still fighting for his release 22 years later because a couple of them felt that they were coerced and lied to. They didn't know that he was going to get life without parole. And unfortunately, he's just representative, of course, of the mass incarceration problem that we have in America. And so I've gotten very involved in that. And then you see that education and poverty and all these opportunities that you don't have in poor neighborhoods feeds into that, what they call the school-to-prison pipeline. So we're kind of addressing all these issues in the film. And, of course, once again, I get involved in a story that turns out to be a very complicated scam. And in the end, mass incarceration is also just all about the money. And that's a shame that most ugly things in America, if you dig deep enough, you will find a monetary and a greed motive behind everything ugly in America. That's a damn shame, but it's the truth.
I listened to a podcast the other day. It's called, not that one. I'm trying to find the one I was listening to. But it has to do, the podcast itself, I'm scrolling down the list of the most popular, and I'm, for some reason, I'm not spotting it. But it has to do with people who were arrested, incarcerated. And the story I listened to the other day was it was a two-parter about a guy that was locked up for 17 years. There was no real evidence that he did anything. I don't know why this isn't showing up on my... It was in iTunes. What the heck was the name of that show? Well, I can't find it now. But are you familiar with it at all? I mean, they eventually it was the Innocence Project that got him released. I mean, the guy was stone cold innocent the entire 17 yeah. years. There was never any question about it. He had, you know, nothing for defense. I mean, it was just
yeah. insane. That's very very similar to Larry Yarbrough's story, and we've, of course, you know, not being able to objectively detach myself from whatever it is I'm involved in. Once again, I seem to now be involved in the efforts to get him released. So I've helped him get a lot of national publicity. We got him back in front of the parole board. And in Oklahoma, our governor, Mary Fallon, America's worst governor, or at least in the bottom three, she has to sign off. We got her out of the parole process on paroles. She used to sign off on all paroles. Now she only signs off on a commutation. And his sentence, because it's life without parole, had to be commuted. Well, she'll never sign off on a commutation. But what we did was we found him an attorney, and they, I guess, behind the scenes worked out this deal where the parole board gave Larry, they commuted his sentence to life with parole. And she did sign off on that, and it was a 4-1 vote, and we thought, great, now he'll go back in front of the parole board, and they can release him directly. That, mm-hmm. that was what we thought was a workaround. Somehow in between those two hearings, and I was 99% certain that he was going to be released after 22 years. Everybody was talking about what kind of a celebration are we going to give for Larry, because he's in a wheelchair, he's mm-hmm. in his 60s, he's in horrible shape. We get in front of the parole board again about 3 to 4 weeks ago. They asked me to speak. I felt really honored to speak on his behalf. And the parole board all of a sudden flips, and they vote 5-0 and don't let him out. Wow. So he's still in. So something happened in between. Some phone calls were made, meetings were had, and somebody said, this guy can't get out. And I can only guess or speculate that they're worried that because his trial was so ugly, it's like the case you were talking about, he's clearly innocent. There's a lot of evidence showing that, but he was lynched, you know, in the trial, basically. There was no way he was going to win that trial no matter what happened. I think there's fear of either just bad publicity or of a lawsuit coming out. And the fact that we're now exposing his case on film and all of that just makes it potentially uglier. So that's the only thing I can guess, because he deserves to be out. Even if he were guilty, which I don't believe he is, 22 years for possession is beyond paying your debt to society. You know, it's heartbreaking. It's honestly heartbreaking. And so we'll continue to fight for Larry Yarbrough. I hope that he is released. I hope that I'm going to tell everybody who owns stock in private prison companies or companies who deal in incarceration, please get out of those stocks. I hope everybody, companies and some mutual funds, are starting to dump and divest themselves of their prison stocks, because it's an immoral practice. And just like
so
we
are
try
you saying
to do,
that state-run prisons are better than the publicly run prisons?
Well, they have a different motive. The thing that happens, and this is now happening in public education as well, is that because of these private prisons who came into being around 1980, in the early 1980s, right after Reagan came into office, and And at the same time the war on drugs was kicked into overdrive, they have a motive to keep you in for longer, and they have a profit motive to cut corners and cut costs. But what they do is their influence through lobbyists and all of that is they gut the public prisons and they let them get run down, and they're now doing it to public education in Oklahoma City, the same methodology. And then they say, look, we have a shiny new prison over here. We can do it better than your public prison is, which we have starved to death, you know. But then once they open, their incentive is to lock up more people. We actually have minimum occupation contracts. In Oklahoma, it's 98%. So if we don't keep the CCA or the GO Group prisons filled and occupied at 98%, we have to pay for those empty beds anyway. So it doesn't give us any incentive to look at I know, which it's. I keep saying that the Marriott would love to have a contract like that when they build a new hotel. Here, come build a hotel. We guarantee you 98% occupancy.
What does it cost to house a prisoner in the state of Oklahoma for 1 year?
The cost on it is generally around $25,000 to $26,000 per year. Now, the largest majority of those are drug-related. So we've increased incarceration by 700% since 1980. A massive. We incarcerate more people than anyone in the world, and Oklahoma incarcerates more women per capita than any place in the world and any state in America. So Oklahoma's sold our soul to private prisons, and so have a lot of other states. But the difference is, if it's a drug-related, a nonviolent offense, you know, someone where you don't have a victim, you just have someone with a drug problem or whatever, it costs $6,000 to $7,000 to treat them all year long, or it costs $26,000 to keep them in prison all year long. And one of them, you know, one of those procedures puts you back into society as a functioning person, and in Larry's case, the other one costs you millions of dollars. It costs, on average, $1 million to keep somebody in prison on a life without parole. In Larry's case, he's now ill, so he's in and out of the hospital, and taxpayers are paying for that too. So in the end, you can pay, in Larry's case, it could be $2 to $3 million to house a guy in prison who really just is not a threat. He's not a threat to society. And even from a monetary cost, we have to look at the idea that we pay at least triple to arrest and incarcerate someone and not rehabilitate them, in reality, than it does to try to rehabilitate them and give them treatment. So it doesn't make moral sense, and it also just doesn't make economic sense. So that was my soapbox moment for the day. So
yeah, okay, so average cost. Average weekly rate for Hilton. Average weekly rate for Hilton. Now that's a daily rate. I want the extended. I want to get a good deal. Okay. All right. Check these out. Because I just did the math on what you said, $25,000 a year in Oklahoma. That's $68 a day, right?
Mm-hmm.
$68 a day. So we could put them up at the Crossland for half that at $36. We could bump them up to the Extended Stay America. Let's see, we're still under at $64.
Still under, yep.
Yeah. And then that's at Candlewoods, exactly right. we exceed the price. And now, again, I don't know how accurate these are, but my point is that the fact that it costs $70 a day to incarcerate someone, now that's if they cause no trouble, That's if they don't need medical care, like your guy.
Exactly.
Now, does
exactly.
that mean I want to just open all the jail cell doors and let, you know, all the criminals run out in the street? No, I'm not suggesting that. I've just always been amazed at how much the American people have to pay to keep someone locked up.
And oh, yeah, it's especially in a time when, especially a state like
now,
Oklahoma,
now the guy at the Crossland's
we don't have
got,
the money.
The guy at the Crossland's got cable. He can control his own AC. You know, he gets fresh towels every day. Somebody comes in, makes his bed, cleans his toilet for $36 a day.
Yeah. Yeah. And we now
and
have
he's,
in
and
the
he's,
private...
And he's probably not getting raped at night.
Exactly. And in the private prisons, we've now had them reduce their staffing to the extent where they become very dangerous and really ugly things. And I won't go into some of the gory details because it's really just disturbing. But one of the stories in our film is a woman who knew she was pregnant and was in a prison in Dallas. Mm-hmm. She had violated a parole over a low-level drug offense, and she missed one of her meetings, one of her drug meetings. She didn't do drugs, she just missed the meeting.
Gotcha.
So they rescinded her parole. They sent her to jail. She felt weird and thought she was pregnant and kept asking for tests. They wouldn't give her tests. They wouldn't give her tests. They wouldn't give her the test. And finally, they kept giving her other medications, thinking she had water weight. She eventually, in a horrible scene, births her child in the hospital. I mean, in the jail cell, and I won't go into the gory details because it's horrible. And that child eventually dies. And this is in a CCA prison in Texas. So, and they didn't have medical on staff like they were supposed to. You know, so these things happen, and riots happen, and prisoners escape, and because their bottom line is to make money. If they can cut costs, they're going to cut costs. And they also don't want you to get out. So they're not trying to rehabilitate and educate you. They're trying to keep you in their hotel, like you said. And here's a great irony in what you just looked up. CCA's very first prison, to give you an idea of how high class of a organization CCA is, their very first prison, they got a contract through connections that they had with the federal government, but they didn't have a prison. And it got down to, and I believe this was immigration detention, if I remember right, it got down to time to open this prison up and accept the prisoners, and they flew to Houston, found a hotel, rented it by the month, put up razor wire around it, and then locked them in the hotel rooms. That was the first private prison in America. Huh. So, clearly a well-planned and entirely legitimate operation. It was almost like CMKM, you know, except that they have grown into a massive, legitimate incarceration company. That, you know, and that's the thing. When you put a profit motive into incarceration, of course they're going to lobby for tougher sentencing. Of course they're going to not let prisoners work their way out of prison on good behavior. Of course they're going to do everything they can to cut corners and make a higher profit margin for their shareholders. And these are all the things that just inherently make private prisons wrong. They came in and said, we can house prisoners for, say, $3 cheaper than you can as a state. But then, as I found out through research, they only take the younger and the low-risk prisoners. So they're taking, as you said, the inherently cheaper prisoners to begin with to make their numbers look better. When Larry Yarbrough got old, he got sent back to the public prison.
Speaking of the young supporting the old, I currently pay, and I know my audience is sick of hearing this, but I pay $1,100 a month for health insurance.
Yeah.
However, because of the deductible, I have to spend $17,000 a year on healthcare before I can get a free Band-Aid. That's my version of affordable healthcare. What's your story?
I had it for a while. I have learned as an activist, this is something you do early on, you learn to live very cheaply. So I've learned to live very cheaply. I make money sometimes on the side. Sometimes I make money doing films. Made a little money off the book, not a lot, you know. So I've learned to nickel and dime my way through life. Right now, I don't have insurance because in Oklahoma, we didn't accept the options of subsidized health care. So if you're over a certain amount of income, you can get on the Affordable Care Act. If you're under that amount, you are just SOL, you know, and I'm in the SOL category right now. So I have nothing, you know, as far as insurance goes. I think affordable care, I think the idea of good affordable health care is a good concept. But when this all got worked on in Congress, you know, between Obama and between Congress, and it got negotiated, and it was almost like financial Wall Street reform. You start out maybe with a good idea, but by the time you're done, it has been sliced and diced and cut up and manipulated by so many lobbyists that it doesn't do any good. So we didn't address healthcare costs. We didn't lower that we have the highest, prescription rate in or monetary cost in the world, that we pay three times more than Canada for prescriptions. We didn't go in and say we need actual reform, and we'll never do reform. That's really the problem. I think if we would take healthcare and say, I actually, if we're going to do it at all, I do agree with the single payer. I believe that I don't think it would work here because we have too many special interests. But ideally, the government gets to say, we now buy more prescriptions than anybody in the world. Therefore, we want to negotiate a good rate for our customers like you. Mm-hmm. But we'll never do that. We'll never do that because big pharma and the medical profession and, you know, they control everything. So instead, all we're really doing is subsidizing big pharma. We didn't help. I don't think we really helped. And of course, yes, people have insurance who didn't have it before. That's a good thing. But we didn't address the cost. We didn't drop a nickel. We didn't negotiate a lower price for drugs.
Yeah, but that's the whole point is, you know, we didn't have to rape 90% of America to insure the other 10%.
That's right. And if they'd done it properly, they would have gone in, as I said, and said, why are we paying triple what Canada pays for prescriptions? Let's now negotiate a better deal for Americans. And then we wouldn't have had a problem with people, you know, universal health care or government subsidized health care. Problem is, we're just subsidizing us getting ripped off through the government. So, and that's one of those things where I agree with Obama on some things. I don't think Obama has done well on Wall Street reform. I don't think Hillary will do anything for Wall Street reform, and I don't think Hillary will do anything to rein in big pharma or medical costs either. And this will just continue on.
And she, well, Benghazi speaks for itself. I mean, she for as far as foreign policy goes, the very thing she was hired to do, there's no hope there. So.
Yeah, well, she's a hawk. I mean, she apparently, and she has enough ties to the military industrial complex that I don't trust her on that either. You know, you if you make weapons, you got to use them, and as long as there's a threat, we're gonna keep making weapons, and people are gonna keep getting rich.
Well, our military is so worn down. I mean, God, Cuba might be able to take us over at this point. I don't know.
We spent old planes
and old boats and old guns and old bullets.
And yet we continue to spend almost half of the money spent on military of the entire world. But what are we getting for that once again? You know, what are we getting? $500 hammers? I don't know. We're getting the same value we get for prescriptions. That's always it. We give everything in to corporate greed.
I got to go out on a limb and say that I'm sure you're no fan of Donald Trump, but what do you think his shot of is sitting in? Do you think he's got a shot at sitting in the Oval Office?
I think he does, and I'm going to say something on your show that I don't normally throw out on my show because there's not a lot of people right here locally probably listening right now. I kind of came on impromptu and didn't really get to advertise this. Although if there's a podcast, I will throw it out there later. But I'm going to go ahead and say this. In some ways, I'm not certain that Donald Trump is necessarily worse than Hillary. And that will piss off some people. I'm sure that's true. But the thing is, I describe Donald Trump. I think Donald Trump is kind of a circus clown. He's a performer.
It's just when you think he's gonna, put on his big boy pants and act presidential, then he goes in and says or does something completely outlandish,
ridiculous.
But it's those outlandish things that allowed him to knock those other 16 people off the stage he was standing on there with.
That's right. He's a performer. He's doing performance art. That's what he's doing up there. He's just, he's a showman, and showmen have to be outrageous. That's kind of a thing. So the risk with Donald Trump is that his talk, and I had, someone I was talking to the other day, she said, I said, well, he's all talk. And she said, yeah, but what about when he's all talk and he has the military to back it up? Is that now a problem?
He's got the checkbook, he's got the military, he's got the codes. I mean, when he's got everything, then what?
Yeah, so of course, that's the risk, is that he goes off script and he does some crazy stuff, which is highly possible, and in fact, maybe even likely. With Hillary, the greatest fear is that she does exactly what she's been bought and paid to do, which is to deliver more money to Goldman Sachs and to Wall Street. So her job will be to make the rich get richer. I'm sorry, but that's true. She is owned by Wall Street, and she is owned by Big Pharma, and she does have ties to private prisons. So I don't trust her, And when you go back to Bill Clinton, I thought Bill Clinton was a good president at the time. And then it turns out that I just happened to be coming up on, I was raising kids and my business was growing. I was doing better. So I assumed, I guess, in my little microcosm, my little bubble, that all of America was being lifted up. Well, it turns out he was responsible for a lot of the horrible sentencing on the war on drugs. So he put more blacks into prison than any other president in history. His policies did that. And turns out he wasn't a great president in every way, and he kind of sold out to Wall Street, and so did she. So I don't trust her either. So here's your deal. Someone who's bought and paid for and a puppet of Wall Street, or someone who's unstable and might just go rogue and pick your poison. So I've been saying lately, pick your poison. Which one do you want to put your risk into?
When it comes to if the rest of the world says what you said, that guy could go rogue. We don't know what he might do next. And he does still have the biggest gun and the biggest checkbook. So maybe we might just better behave, because there's no telling what this guy could do.
Could do. Yeah, I agree. I'm not thrilled with either of our choices right now, quite frankly.
He might make a good president just because he's frightening.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And honestly, part of me, I would not bet on this, even with odds, but part of me thinks he's just talking because he knows it's playing to the audience, you know, and that he might go in and be president and go, you know, I was just spouting off. Now I'm going to be a decent president. Maybe, I don't know, but I, you know.
Do you think he knows how to be a decent president?
No, probably not. But he
built a great company. I mean,
yeah, 5 or 6 bankruptcies and it worked really well, yeah. You know, but he, you know, that's the guy who you go, this guy might just be all talk, but do I want to hand him a gun and then stand in the line of fire? No, I don't. So don't get me wrong. I fear the unknown craziness of Donald Trump, but I know exactly what I'm getting with Hillary Clinton, and I don't like that either. So, hell, I don't know. I may be voting third party this year. Doesn't matter in Oklahoma, because we always vote for the Republican. So Oklahoma will go to Donald Trump.
Right.
But symbolically, maybe I vote third party this year. I don't know. You know? I know that doesn't sound very optimistic that I'm saying.
Now, this guy that they've talked about being this independent candidate, what's his name?
There's the Libertarian, Gary Johnson, I think.
That's not going to happen.
There's
another guy they just brought up the other day about.
Really?
Military guy.
We've got the Green Party here trying to get Jill Stein on the ballot, and actually she's pretty good. Of course, third-party candidates don't have a chance in hell, but I might symbolically vote for the actual qualified woman and vote for Jill Stein if she's on the ballot here.
Yeah, thanks, John. The guy's name was French. David French.
Huh, okay. I'll have to look him up.
I mean, they're talking about... I don't know where he's at in the headlines today, but a couple days ago, they were talking about David French. Did you mean David French? I did mean David French. David French. Donald Trump's campaign threatened my wife. Now that, of course, from the reliable Gawker, one day ago. So,
always accurate. Yeah, always accurate.
Let me jump to some real side. Inside the never Trump candidacy that almost was. The man in question, David French, himself a National Review writer, was joined in that tiny New England hamlet by some of the country's top. French says Trump's racial... Oh, boy. French alleges Trump campaign threatened him. It goes on and on. Why David French isn't running for president. Bloomberg published this 19 years ago. Of course we can trust Bloomberg. With all due respect, David French discussed why he decided against launching his third-party campaign for the presidency and if there is still a chance for an independent candidate. So... looks like he was in, left foot in, and then the left foot out. So,
okay.
Anyway, well, so tell me about your show real quick before you go here. What do you do on your show nowadays? What do you talk about? What's your topic of discussion?
Well, it's called Red State Radio, which is kind of a joke, play on words, because Oklahoma is, you know, red dirt and called the reddest state in America. And I'm clearly not that red, you know. So I do a lot of state politics and national politics. I do the same thing I did back in the old days, which is rile some people up and make them want to do something positive and just piss off other people. Because that's apparently what I do best. I just want people to get out of their easy chairs and go out and you know, follow what you believe in and try to get involved somehow. So a lot of it is Oklahoma politics, but as I say, a lot Oklahoma reflects on the national. I keep saying we're the testing ground, we're the test market for everything oppressive. So you can take Oklahoma and project it onto Kansas or any other Midwestern state, and they're going to be doing it next. So they test it here, and it's kind of sad. And in fact, our horrible governor who got us into the $1.3 billion budget shortfall is on, believe it or not, Donald Trump's short list of vice presidential nominees, Mary Fallon. And that's crazy, you know. But anyway, the show, if it's a toginet.com, but you can go to Facebook.
I'm on the shows page right now, and I'm looking for – what's the name of your show?
It's called Red State Radio. And you can go to Facebook and here just type in Red State Radio with Mark Faulk. Yep. It's every Thursday, 5 to 6 Eastern Standard Time, 4 to 5 Central Time. And then there's podcasts. I have a lot of politicians on, candidates for office right now. I'm doing a lot of Oklahoma candidates. Tomorrow, for instance, we have kind of – we had 50 teachers who went – I throw that number out. I might not be totally accurate. But we had a lot of teachers who went out – and decided to run for office at the last minute, mm-hmm. and all filed to run for office this year because they gutted education so badly. It's kind of cool. It's kind of a so the seeds of an uprising have been sown in Oklahoma, and I of course am watering the seeds every week and every day. So every Thursday, 4 to 5 Central Time, 5 to 6 Eastern Time.
And so who runs shop these days over at Toginet?
There's a couple of people down there. I don't really know kind of who's running the entire thing. Kevin West was asked to come back and kind of run it for a while. He did it for a little while. He's not now. I can't remember Eric's last name.
Oh, Eric. Yeah, I used to talk to Eric every Friday morning, trying to get things hooked up and squared away, because that was our day. We did Friday mornings.
Yeah, I think he's kind of inherited it down there, and they're plugging along. I don't think it has ever, and I don't know if it will ever, become a real money-making proposition. But I use it for what it's worth, which is a mouthpiece to spout off a little bit each week.
Right.
And it's still fun, you know. It's fun coming on here, though. We should do this more often.
Well, I'd like to invite you to come once a week for, 15 minutes, half hour, whatever you can spare out of your time. Email me a day that's good for you. Needs to be around this time. And I think we could do some good radio again.
That would be fun. I feel amazingly comfortable. I was thinking, what are we going to talk about today? And we're like, oh, we could talk for 6 hours about anything and everything, like we always did, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. No, so we did some great radio back in the day, and sometimes it did run a couple, 3-4 hours. Email me. Let me know when you can
Absolutely.
Come back. Thanks. It's just good to talk to you, man.
You too, really absolutely. Good. I'm glad to hear that you're still doing this. So I'll get with you. We'll start to do it. I'll throw it out to my people, and we'll get some.
If you'd asked me 10 years ago, would I still be doing this 10 years later? I would have probably said I don't think so. But here I am.
But here you are.
It must
be the right path. Then it's great to talk to you, Dwayne.
Hey man, take care. God bless.
All right.
See you soon.
You too.
All right. Bye bye. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend, Mr. Mark Faulk, Red State Radio. Check him out on Toginet Radio, which, interestingly enough, once upon a time was bought. CFRN was bought by Toginet. Let me kill Mark's mic so he, or Mike's Mark, Mark's mic, so he can go back to living the quiet life. There you go. Now, All right, he's muted. Let's see, how did it go? Toginet by CFRN. Yep, boy, that was way back in the day, 2007. On the fucking truth, it says, so, what do we got? Toginet. Entertainment Incorporated is extremely pleased to announce that we have acquired CFRN.net. Our long-term plan is to use the network and its well-established audience as a foundation to build a broad-based radio internet network, tentatively called Togi Network, rated the number one network on Street IQ. After beating out 25,000 other financial shows, CFRN will remain a cornerstone of Togi Internet Radio, expand its programming, and become a subsidiary of Togi Entertainment. And you can read the rest of that if you care to. From CEO Mark Faulk, Togi Entertainment is excited to have the chance to bring quality internet radio to the masses. Our programming will not be controlled by the forces that currently influence America's media, giving us the opportunity to provide politics, entertainment, and information beyond the narrow parameters of mainstream media. Mark Faulk, Dwayne Reeves, and John Martin, CEO of the Owners Group Incorporated, will discuss the future of Togi Internet Radio on Friday, March 9th, airing at 11:30 a.m. Eastern on CFRN.net, immediately following the Faulking Truth from 10 to 11:30 a.m. Eastern. This was before Togi had a radio station. Togi was buying CFRN. Unfortunately, Togi was unable to fulfill their end of the deal, and so the sale never was fully consummated, which I guess was God's way of saying, that's not my plan. So there you have it. All right, so send in. Oh, John's saying that Mr. French has declined the offer to be the next president. All right, okay, let's shoot through the rest of these concierge trade alerts real quick because I got an afternoon full of stuff. Where did we leave off? Crude oil? Did we already cover that? I think we did, but let me make sure. Yep, $570 per contract right here. Okay, this little bump here, but it went higher. It's just kind of sideways. All right, next would be the NQ. Let's hit that real quick. NQ. I think we're going to find that here, tucked away over here. Close enough. All right, NQ, last night. Drop the flag, 2000. Okay. NQ. Looking to buy 45.18. 45.18. Right there. Amazing how that happens. Market after market, day after day. I just am stunned by it. 45. It's three markets in a row. That's the nature of math, where we came right up, tapped it. Okay, based upon your stop, you didn't have to be stopped out here. And if you caught the ride, you caught the ride all the way up to 45.30. So the word was buy 45.18. Okay, sometimes you just got to hang in there. Buy 45.18. Okay, and the swing high, 45.30. So that would be 22 points. At $5 per point available. Of course, we don't get out at the exact swing high or the exact swing low. So if you take 20 points and you, $20 a point. That's not a bad trade. Not at all. And then it comes back and, of course, does it again from 45.18 up to 25. So there's 7. So, wait a minute, 18. Come on, 18 to 30 is 22. Okay, and then 18 to 25, it's 7.75. So, and now it's doing it a third time. Well, that's good to see, I guess. You need 5 points, $20 a point times 5 points. There you go. $100 per point, okay? At a $440 move here, but you just need 5, not 22, if you're just trading to get your goal for the day. Well, there it is. All right? So after the NQ, we go to bonds. U, we are in the month of U. Yoo-hoo. All right. Let's drop our marker at 2,000 hours. And by the way, you could be taking these trades every day yourself. All you got to do is sign up. All right, 2,000 hours. And the word on bonds was to buy 167.13. And that didn't happen. Okay, we had no opportunity to buy 167.13. The market did not climb high enough. Nor did it drop low enough for 166.03. So here's a day in bonds. Occasionally this happens in bonds. No trigger. No trigger for bonds today. We'll come back and play again tomorrow. All right, gold. What do we got? There's gold. Okay. Drop our marker at 2,000. Okay. Okay. All right. Gold, we were looking to buy 1249. We got triggered on this one beautifully. Most beautifully. 1249. Buy. Come on. Back to 1249. Now this is a weak maker. Gold's been good for that lately. Buy 1249. Okay. And then just up she goes. Now from 1249 to 1259, that's $1,000 per contract. Okay. $1,000 per contract available. $1,000 per contract available. $1,249 to $1,259. Now, at 1269, that would have been $2,000 per contract. We didn't quite make it to 69. We got it to 1,000. We got it, oh gosh, all the way up to a swing high at 67. But we got a rule of thumb that says anytime you make $1,000 per contract, just take it. And so we'll leave it with the just take it. But from, I just got to say, from 59 up to 67, that's another roughly $800. So this was basically about an $1,800 per contract move. I'll round it down just to be, just to show I really am a conservative. Because you might have trailed your stop. You never know. All right. So that takes care of gold. What do I got left? Soybeans. Oh, them beans. All right. Let's drop our marker at 2,000. And then the word on beans was by 11:44. Okay. If you bought 11:44, right there, by 11:44. What do you end up with? 11:44 up to 11:88. So that's 44 points. Times $50 per point. So we'll just call it 2K per contract day. How about that? 2K per contract day. There you have it. Soybeans. Gotta love those beans. Well, I won't stare at it too long. That would be rude. I'll put it back on the S&P, see what's happening there. That's not the S&P I need. Where is the S&P? Did I put it up here? Yeah. There we go. Okay. So the S&P is still climbing. Again, our number for the week, we're looking for, since Sunday night, 2125. And, of course, it's come back to test the entry a couple times, but it's still plugging along on its way. Can it get there? Doesn't have that far to go, really. One good push or rush of something and we'd be there already. All right, guys, I got mentoring sessions to do. Thanks so much for tuning in today. If you enjoyed hearing from our new guest Mark, send me some emails, let me know so I can forward them to him, and we'll get him back for 15-30 minutes a week, whatever he can spare between his filmmaking and book writing and all that other good stuff. He's a great guy. I've known him for a long time. Again, we don't agree on everything, especially politically. I'm far to the right, and he's not far to the left. It's kind of in the middle of the road, but brilliant guy. He's done a lot in his life. Again, we met over the financial markets because they were twisted and corrupt and wrong and bad and evil, and that was the part of the birth of CFRN. So, anyway, I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you'll join us. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Whoever you are, wherever you are, may God continue to richly bless you with His mercy and with His grace. And I'll see you at the bell.
Remember this. There is no greater return on investment than to see a human life changed and given hope. As always, pray hard and trade safe. Any financial information discussed on this show is simply the opinion of our host, Dwayne Reeves, his co-host and guest. To learn more about trading E-mini futures or to take a one-week free trial in our live trading room, call 1-866-928-3310. 866-928-3310. Information discussed on this radio program should not be construed as a recommendation to buy or sell any security. Always do your own due diligence and consult with a licensed securities broker or financial planner before making any investment decisions.